All right, so we're getting going here. Why is the chat disabled? That doesn't help us at all. Oh, naughty. Sorry, now my cat's bothering me. Hold on, getting started here. I may be here alone, which is just as well, because then I can make mistakes and edit it later, which would be nice. I'm really quickly just going to email everybody. And then the, okay, Kat, you cannot, you have to not stand here. Thank you. Everybody. Tell I haven't done this before. All right. Well, for some reason, chat is disabled. I don't know why. That is not how I had hoped to have it be. So you can always text me if for some reason you get online at some point, or you can follow me in the Google Hangout. All right. So today, the plan is to talk a little bit about atrial fibrillation, and then we'll talk a little bit about angina. And that'll be it. So there's really only, I guess, four main conditions we're going to talk about with the in terms of cardiac drugs. Heart failure, which hopefully you've watched the videos about, so you know about heart failure. And the whole point of heart failure is to reduce afterload, reduce preload, and increase the strength of contraction of the heart. We're also going to talk about angina. I'm going to do that shortly, in which the main... Thank you, Kishi. The main goals of therapy are to prevent the formation of clots, dilate the coronary vessels, and reduce the work of the heart, mostly by inhibiting the heart rate with beta blockers. And then the last one is going to be atrial fibrillation. Now, you have an assignment that you need to do where you're going to look at the current AHA recommendations for atrial fibrillation. These recommendations come out every couple of years for pretty much every condition. The American Heart Association does the ones for all the different heart conditions. And you're expected to just sort of know these things and be able to read the articles. Once you've read a couple of them, it's much easier to sort of glean the information out of the articles that you need. But I thought it was important for you to look at that, not only because you should learn a little bit about atrial fibrillation and how to manage it, but also because the one of the things I really like about these recommendation papers is that they have what's called level of evidence and basically what they're showing. It's what they show tell you is the amount of evidence for every recommendation, and you'd be surprised how many recommendations are actually due simply to sort of what everyone's done, and nobody's done a study to discover that it doesn't work anymore. So there's that. And then also the sort of the risk versus the benefit of the treatment. So some treatments, the benefit way outweighs the risk. Some treatments sort of equal. Some of them, actually, the treatment is worse than the benefits of getting the disease. And of course, as you know, with pharmacology, at least, all drugs have side effects, all of them. Everything. So you always have to weigh the risk of a side effect with the treatment. All right. So I think what I'll do is let me take a look at the handout. Now, if you don't have the handout, go to either D2L or go to my boyhub.com website and print it out. I believe here, I'm going to screen share here. There's going to be a tunnel to another dimension here in a second. So just hang on for just 1 second. Okay. Let's do this. All right, sorry, tunnel to another dimension. Try not to get horribly dizzy by that. So let me just show you the, that's my website. And the handout that you're going to want to get is the heart and BP handout. Okay, so that's the one for this lecture. I do have the atrial fibrillation guidelines worksheet, and the reading for that are already here also. So you can download that either there or at D2L. But this is the handout you're going to want to look at. And this is the one that really has actually more information than you need. Because, actually, let me show you a different. Oh, God. The wormhole to eternity is showing. All right. So this is the first page of the handout, and it just gives you an overview of what we're going to, you know, what you're going to need to talk to learn about. Now, what I've gotten in terms of feedback from students is that to teach a lot of stuff about arrhythmias isn't that useful at this point in the in your career, because you haven't had ACLS, you haven't really learned a lot of, you haven't learned how to look at EKGs or anything like that. So the only arrhythmia I want you to look at is atrial fibrillation, okay? Now this first page is actually just a table that a student asked me to make a couple, I think a year or two ago. And it's just a sort of an overview. So right now it might not make any sense, but hopefully by the time you're finished looking at this handout, all of this will make sense, right? So again, the only arrhythmia I'm really gonna have you look at is atrial fibrillation, about left heart failure and angina. Okay, what should we do first? Let's start with atrial fibrillation, actually, because I think that's kind of an interesting one. So atrial fibrillation is, I only have one page on this handout. It's on page 21. I know, right? Make sure you print this out somewhere where you don't have to pay for ink, I think, because it's quite a large handout. Okay. All right. So if you hopefully watched the crash course videos on the heart, and I think believe the second one about the heart was about restarting a heart that has stopped. And in particular, they talk about fibrillation and using the shock paddles, the crash cart to stop ventricular fibrillation. And basically the idea there was that you use the electrical shock of the defibrillator to stop all of the electrical activity in the heart. And then you that allows the pacemaker cells to sort of restart at the correct rhythm. So the idea of fibrillation is that if you have more than just those pacemaker cells, the SA node in what part of the heart? The right atrium, right? Okay. So you have those pacemaker cells in the right atrium, and they are letting out a electrical charge, sort of an action potential. It's a cardiac action potential in the heart, and that spreads throughout the atrium. And then that spreads into the ventricle, so that you get these nice even contractions. In the atrium, you get a nice squeeze, and in the ventricle, you get a nice squeeze. And so the whole heart is squeezing in unison, and it's very efficient, and it's squeezing blood all the way throughout your body and just doing a great job. If you have more than just that one little set of pacemaker cells in the SA node, then what happens is it's firing, and then another area of the heart is firing, another area is firing, and pretty soon the heart is all just wibbly-wobbly. Right? Now, if that happens in your ventricle, you have about 3 minutes to live, because you have to have your ventricle or else you can't live because it's pumping the blood out to your whole body. So if you don't have blood pumping to your whole body, you die because you need blood going to your brain and your organs and everything. In the atrium, however, if you have fibrillation of just the atria, right? So just the atria is all wibbly wobbly and not contracting smoothly. You can have that and you actually don't die right away. And some people live for quite a long time with that. Some people live very long time. Some people drop dead the next day. So the reason that atrial fibrillation is dangerous is that you, whenever you have that wibbly-wobbliness of the atrial muscular wall of the heart, instead of having that nice squeeze as the blood flows through, you get turbulence. So now you have areas in the atria that are turbulent, and so there's areas that where the blood is getting all squished up, and then there's areas in the atria where it's just like puddles, like the blood is just sort of stagnant. And whenever you have turbulence or stagnation of blood, you're at the risk for a blood clot. Okay, so a blood clot in itself isn't the end of the world, right? I mean, it's I mean, you have to have blood clots in order to, you know, heal any wound that you might have. So clots are a good thing, generally speaking. But the problem of forming a clot in your atria is that it can lead to some very bad things. So let's sort of figure this out. I have on this little Word document here. Let's see, what have I written here? Okay, so I have here, a blood clot in the right ventricle can lead to. So I've narrowed it down for you. There's just two possibilities. Okay, you can have a stroke or a pulmonary embolism. If it's in the right ventricle, okay, left, right, right ventricle, then the next place it goes to is the lungs, right? Sorry, so you have a blood clot in the right, oh, that's not even right. That makes me want to cry. I mean, this is the same thing would be in a ventricle, but let's do it this way. I'm going to just change this right now. Okay, so let's start with the right atrium, since we're talking about atrial fibrillation, right? All right, so blood clot in the right atrium goes to the right ventricle and then goes to the lungs, right? And again, the blood vessels from the heart into the lungs get smaller and smaller and smaller as they become capillaries, right? So at some point, if you have a big clot, it's going to go into your lungs and then just clot and block the lungs. And so if it blocks the lungs, you get what's called a pulmonary embolism. And anytime you have a giant, the size of the clot's important. If you have a giant blockage of the blood supply to your lungs, that is not good. That's pulmonary embolism. You can die from that. It's not good. But worse is if you have a blood clot in your left atrium. Okay. So blood clot in your left atrium goes to the left ventricle, which then goes to the aorta, right? And remember, the aorta kind of like curves around, and then there's like some big trunks that come up, and one of them goes to your arm, and then there's two that are here that are your carotid arteries, which then go to your brain. So if you have a clot in your left atrium, that can actually end up in your brain, which is called a thromboembolic stroke. I'm sorry, I'm distracted because the cat has jumped up and started knocking stuff off the table here in order to drive me mad. So if things go crazy for a second, it's due to animals. Anyway, okay, so a blood clot in the right atrium can lead to pulmonary embolism. Let's do something to make that look like it's, there we go. That's a little better, right? All right, and a blood clot in the left atrium can lead to a thromboembolic stroke, which is not good. All right. Again, you can live with atrial fibrillation for a while because the atria are sort of the receiving chamber of the heart. They're not the part of the heart that pumps the blood around your body. So if the ventricles are just pumping along at their normal rate and as strongly as they normally would, then that's fine. And you can live for a while like that. I have to move the cat here. sorry. And that really confuses me when the animals jump into my field of vision. All right. And that's why you can live for a while like that, because the atria can just be wibbly wobbly and make clots. Okay. So the length of your life or quality of your life is going to be dependent on how well you make clots. All right. So right away, even if you don't know anything else about atrial fibrillation, you know that clots are the problem, which means that probably drugs that help you not make clots are going to be the thing you want to use. All right, in terms of causes of atrial fibrillation, there's lots of different causes. Oh no, I've done something terrible here. Okay, here we go. I have a lot of things listed here. Hyperthyroid is like a classic thing that can cause atrial fibrillation, but sort of long-term problems can do it. So in terms of treatments, you wanna use some kind of anticoagulant. And we're going to talk about anticoagulants when we talk about angina. But the idea is that if you prevent the formation of clots, you're going to prevent the complication of atrial fibrillation. Generally speaking, you don't give patients medications as outpatient, medications that would break up clots. Because your body makes clots all day long. Every time you bang your finger or something a little bit, you get a you have a little micro injury and your body, makes a little clot and fixes the little injury. So it's a sort of risky thing to give somebody a drug that will break down all the clots in their whole body. Now that you do, you will see those drugs, and you'll see them given to patients if they're in the midst of a stroke or a heart attack, or it's used within during heart procedures and things like that. So those drugs exist. But generally speaking, drugs like aspirin, heparin, warfarin, those kind of anticoagulant drugs that people call blood thinners, what those drugs are really doing is just preventing you from forming a clot and then letting your body take care of breaking down the clot. So anticoagulants, again, blood thinners, they don't really thin your blood. They just make it more difficult to form a clot. All right, so so now atrial fibrillation. Okay, so atrial fibrillation, again, caused by a weird, what's called ectopic focus, basically a weird area of new pacemaker cells that are beating at a different rate than the SA node, and that's the problem. So to treat the disease, you do the anticoagulation to prevent clot formation. You do something to fix the atrial fibrillation, right? So that would be an antiarrhythmic drug, so drugs that fix arrhythmias. And actually, we're only going to talk about a couple of them. There's a lot of different drugs you could use for this, but we're specifically going to mention digoxin as one of them. You can also use calcium channel blockers. There's a bunch of different drugs you could use for that. And then weirdly, after lots of studies were done, it was discovered that you could also reduce mortality from atrial fibrillation by just lowering the ventricular rate. So when you measure heart rate, when you check somebody's pulse, what you're checking is the rate at which their heart is beating. And that's usually, that's the ventricular rate, right? That's the rate of the heart, of the ventricle squeezing the blood throughout your body. And it was discovered sort of through one way or another, it was discovered that if you just lower the rate of the heartbeat, even if you don't fix the weird wibbly wobbly atrial fibrillation, the patient's mortality rate goes down. They live longer, right? So those are sort of the main tenets of treatment for atrial fibrillation. And what I'm going to have you read is this long guideline for the management of patients with atrial fibrillation. When you print it out, you only need to print out the first 20 pages because it's quite a large document. And look at the assignment. You'll see that I walk you through the article, showing you how to read the article. And then at the end, I give you a case study and a patient and their description. And then your job is to use the article to figure out how to treat the patient, what to use to help that patient. Okay, so that is all I'm really going to say in class about atrial fibrillation. After you've done that assignment, hopefully we'll have some more things to talk about in terms of that. Now, let's see. I'm going to stop screen sharing for just a second. And let's just make sure there's nobody. Oh, there's six people watching. Oh, how fantastic. All right, so what I'd like to do now is change gears and go to angina. All right, so angina starts on page 2 of the handout. All right, and I used to have angina sort of after we talked about heart failure, but I think angina actually is an easier sort of disease to get your head around, mostly because you see people with it all the time in movie theaters. That's like, I guess if you, that would be very unfortunate if you always went to a movie and people were having heart attacks, that would be bad. But in movies, there's usually a guy having chest pain or somebody, and they're like, oh, I just had this, oh, my heart, I just had terrible news. And then they have chest pain and they take out a little bottle and they take little pills and stick it in their mouth. And then after a minute, they feel better. So that's an actual thing. All right, and you have what angina means. Angina pectoris means pain in your pecs, in your chest, right? And angina, the pain of angina is from the muscle of the heart itself not having enough oxygen. So let me go back to this. I'm going to go back. So watch out. Here comes the time tunnel to the edge of the universe. Okay, there we go. All right, so angina. Now, chest pain from not having enough oxygen in your heart actually comes in a bunch of varieties, right? We're going to talk about the least miserable version of that. Let's see. which is stable angina or exertional angina. And what that is pain that comes on with exertion or stress, or you hear bad news, or you eat a really huge meal. All sorts of things can trigger it. And it's triggered by basically your heart needing to work harder than it would have worked before. This is predictable pain that if the patient goes and takes a little rest, they feel better. Now, what's interesting is that obviously if the chest pain goes away, then that's angina. If the chest pain persists, then that can be either unstable angina or it can be one of a variety of different types of myocardial infarction. Myocardial infarction, again, is just the medical term for heart attack, right? So that's a myocardial infarction suggests that the blood supply in the coronary vessel is completely blocked. And so that tissue that the coronary vessel was feeding is completely dead and gone. So, sorry, cat issues here. All right, so that, and what's interesting about it is that men tend to have that chest pain as being a crushing, they've described as crushing chest pain, which sometimes radiates down the arm. I think everybody sort of knows about that and knows that's sort of like when it's really bad, that's a heart attack. Women, for some reason, have much less, sort of those classic signs don't always appear. So women might have a heart attack and their symptom might be they have jaw pain or they have stomach pain or they just get really nauseated or they break out in a sweat. When I was a fellow at in Boston, I was training with some guys that were in a big ophthalmology practice in Boston. And so there was a big area of offices, huge waiting room. And one day, one of the patients had locked herself in the bathroom. And when we went in there, she was dead. Because what had happened was she had gone with her friends to her eye doctor. Old people tend to go to doctor appointments as a social event. So a lot of times you'd see groups of, these groups of 90-year-old women that would come in and they'd all get their eyes examined the same day, like as a little fun girls' day out, which is sort of fun. Anyway, she'd been sitting with her friend and said, "Oh, I have a stomach ache. Oh, I better go to the bathroom." But it wasn't a stomach ache; it was a heart attack. So, just be aware that sometimes weird pain in odd places can sometimes be referred pain from the heart, and just sort of be on the lookout for that. All right. So now the thing about angina is that it's due to a mismatch between the amount of oxygen that the heart is getting and the amount of oxygen that the heart is using, right? So the heart uses more oxygen when it is beating harder, right? And of course the oxygen supply comes from the coronary vessels. And I feel like I should be drawing. I feel like I need to draw some of this. Oh, hold on. I'm going to try to draw this. I hope that this doesn't make the entire program go completely bonkers by having an extra thing open. But I just feel that this will work so much better if I can make a drawing. Didn't I just have one called? Yeah. All right. So, So angina, we don't want to hear that. Okay. So let's have a pen. All right. So if you can imagine, I hope this is showing up. Text me if it's not. This is crazy. Anyway, all right. So what happens is, say you have, here's a coronary vessel, all right, and here's the coronary vessel leads to some portion of your heart. This is not an anatomically correct heart. It's just sort of heart shaped. Okay, so here's the coronary vessel, and there's an area where and blood is flowing through the coronary vessel at rest, and then it's supplying some portion of the heart. Okay, so there's this portion of the heart that's being supplied. Okay, let's do something here. Let's try this instead. Okay. All right, so this blood is coming into the heart and then supplying some area of heart around it. Right? So at rest, your heart is beating a normal rate, which is maybe 60 to 100 beats a minute. And your coronary vessels are some given resting diameter, because when your heart is only beating, 60 or 70 or 60 or 100 beats per minute, which is normal for the heart, then you only need a certain amount of blood. But now say you start getting chased by a bear, or you decide to go work out, or something like that, right? All right, so now what's happening is you have to, your heart has to beat quite a lot faster, right? So when you're, uh-oh, Dr. Boyev, it's not showing. Okay, thank you. Thank you for letting me know. All right, let's try. Okay. Let's try that. Is it showing now? Hold on a second. Oh no. Oh, now it's now we have the eternal wormhole to nowhere. You guys are so nice to like put up with this. What do we got here? I don't know why you can't make comments. I specifically want you to make comments, and for some reason it's not allowing it. Oh God, it's so awful when it does it. We don't see a picture. You don't see anything drawing. Oh dear. This is why I have to do these things on, this takes me. Yeah, it's working now? Okay, thank you. All right, so let's just start over, and maybe someday I can go back and edit that out. Okay, so all right, so you have your coronary arteries are going. Yeah. Okay, thank you. Thank you. Sorry, guys. All right, so normally, say you're going 60 or 100 beats a minute is your normal situation. Okay, so now you want to go a lot faster. And wow, don't do that. All right, so let's make it really pink here. All right, so now we want to go a lot faster, and so we want to really rev things up. And when you do that, you actually get a dilation of the coronary vessels. And in fact, at sort of maximum work of the heart, your coronary vessels dilate 4 to 5 times their normal size. All right. Oh, yeah. It's not making an X. That is an ugly picture. I apologize. But the idea is that the more your heart works, the coronary arteries dilate so that you can get more oxygen flowing to that myocardial tissue. And the problem, and you might say, well, why not just have, your coronary vessels dilated all the time? And the reason you don't have it dilated all the time is because again, it's wasteful. The heart has got to beat your whole life, and so you want everything to be efficient. So if most of the time you spend just sort of sitting on the couch and, you know, eating Doritos and playing Halo, which is not a bad way to live your life, let's just say, then you never get a lot of that dilation of your coronary vessels. And what happens over time, you get years and years and years and years and years go by, is that if you're not exercising your heart very often, those coronary vessels don't have the opportunity to dilate very much, which means they start to get stuck. You know, they get sort of stuck in this, perpetual air situation where they're constantly thin. And if you have hypertension or other medical problems, you might actually get something called arteriosclerosis. So arteriosclerosis might be a situation. Is it making a draw? Nope. Let's try using a color. That will work better. All right, so you may have a situation where over the years, not only does the artery, the coronary artery not get dilated very often, but it doesn't, it no longer can stretch. So it no longer can dilate. So arteriosclerosis means artery. Sclerosis means hardening, so hardening of the arteries. Also, what can happen is that you might have a situation where you've spent your whole life eating sort of Big Macs. And you might have, Big Mac, filled up in your coronary arteries, right? All right. So that, even when they do stretch out, there's hardly any blood flowing to the heart. Right. So the idea when you're treating angina is number one, to try to increase blood flow in the heart. So we're gonna say increase flow. And you increase blood flow in a couple of ways, but one of the easiest ways is to just dilate the coronary arteries. All right, so you're dilating coronary arteries, that will help the blood flow into the heart. Now, unfortunately, if you're really old and you have terrible arteriosclerosis, then it's going to be difficult to dilate the arteries, but you know, you do your best. Now, the other thing that you do is you don't want the blood flow within the vessel to get blocked because if it's completely blocked off, then that's a heart attack. And if it's partially blocked off, then it just makes your angina worse, right? Because you don't want like a big nasty clot forming. And then the blood can barely get past, or it just stops completely. So one thing you want to do also is to keep clots from forming, right? So prevent, clearly need to work on this. Okay, to prevent clots. Okay, all right. So to prevent clots, you can use blood thinners. All right, this is just not pretty at all. Okay. All right. And blood thinners, again, the same idea is that you use blood thinners to prevent clots from forming and let the body break down clots if you need to have that happen. So again, you can use blood thinners in atrial fibrillation specifically to prevent clots from forming that will then become emboli to either the lungs or the heart, will become either pulmonary embolism to the lungs or a clot to the brain, which is a stroke. In angina, you're preventing clots because you want to keep that vessel from getting blocked off. All right, now, the last thing you can do to help a patient with angina is that you can do something to reduce the heart's oxygen consumption, right? So one of the ways you can do reduce oxygen consumption, what color have I not used? I don't think I've used green. All right, is to, number one, you can reduce heart rate, okay? Right, because if the heart is beating slowly or not beating too fast, then there's not a problem that there's gonna be enough blood flow to the heart, right? And the way you reduce heart rate is with our old buddies, the beta blockers, right? That's as good as me. So you can reduce heart rate that way. Now, another way that you can reduce the work that the heart has to do is you can reduce preload and you can reduce afterload, which are terms that you know from the heart failure video. And that preload, just again, is the blood pushing its way into the heart, you know, and trying to shove its way in there and trying to stretch the heart out. Afterload is the pressure from the aorta pushing back into the ventricles. Both preload and afterload make it harder for the heart to work. It makes more work for the heart. The heart has to work harder in order to overcome the afterload and preload. That's why afterload and preload are such a disaster in heart failure, because the heart's already weak, so it can hardly keep up anyway. In angina, let's just assume that if we have a patient with pure angina and nothing else is wrong with them, we can say, okay, well, the muscle itself is perfectly fine and the heart is perfectly able to beat. It's just a question of maybe the coronary artery is too thin. Well, in that case, the heart is okay when it's just beating along normally. But if you increase preload or afterload, it's just going to make it more difficult for the heart to work. And if the heart is having to work harder, it's going to have to use more oxygen, and that's no good. All right, well, I'm going to get rid of this incredibly ugly diagram, and I'll try to make something neater and give it to you guys later. Okay, so again, let me know if nothing is showing. And again, you guys are welcome to join the Google Hangout of Infinite Wormhole at any point. I did send you guys a link in your email. Hopefully you got that too. All right, so let's go ahead and talk about the different treatment drugs. This initial part, I mean, I suppose I should go over this. Because I'm mostly interested in just stable angina, which is just this issue where the blood supply isn't good enough, and if you rest, it gets better. But there's some other kinds of angina. It's probably worth mentioning at this point. One is unstable angina, which is just the next step up, right? So that's the chest pain that you normally have, but you sit down or rest and the pain doesn't go away. So that means that now, even at the normal heart rate at rest, your heart is not getting enough oxygen, which usually means that there's been a clot, or maybe something's partially blocked off, or something bad is happening. That's an emergency. You need to go to an emergency room and have something done about that. And if you're taking care of a patient, you need to, you know, call the alarm. The patient needs to be taken care of. And then from unstable angina, you have all different types of heart attack, which you'll learn about later. And the treatments for those are varying depending on the type of heart attack, and the depending also on which type of myocardial infarction a person is undergoing. The treatment is more or less urgent and all sorts of things like that. So let's stay with something simple and just say let's just stay with the simple stuff. Okay, so let's start again with this anticoagulant business. Now, you already know one, which is aspirin. Aspirin's like, oh, I love aspirin. It's such a great drug. Because if you recall, it's made from willow bark and it can treat pain, fever, inflammation, and it can thin your blood, anticoagulate your blood. And it does that by making the platelets in your blood less sticky. So if they can't stick together, they can't make a clot easily. Aspirin, again, you'll remember pharmacokinetically is really interesting because the low-dose aspirin, the 81 milligrams. Now, hopefully you guys can now see the handout. If you can't, let me know. I want to know. The 81 milligram dose of aspirin has a very short half-life, 15 or 20 minutes, which means within an hour or two, it's out of your system, but it thins your blood for longer because it inhibits those platelets, which then you just have to wait for your body to make more platelets, which is such a great drug because that means you don't have these other side effects because it just like does its job on the platelets and then just leaves at the low dose. At the higher dose, it has a much longer half-life. You know that aspirin toxicity is called salicylism, and it's ringing in the ears and tingling in the fingers. You also know that, what else do you know? You know that you shouldn't, generally speaking, give it to people under the age of 18 because of Reye syndrome, which is sort of a rare but scary and very dangerous condition that children can get who have the flu or chickenpox who take aspirin. And I think that's sort of the main things about aspirin. But in terms of angina and heart attack, the aspirin can reduce the chances that you're going to die by up to a third, depending on the studies, like 15 to 30%. I actually have a story about this. I have a story about everything, right? When I was in the Northbrook Choir years ago, and we went to Washington and we got to sing in one of these festival choirs at the Lincoln Center, which was all good. It's very exciting. And I took my son and our whole group went down on a bus. It was really fun. And we flew and then we're driving around on a bus. Anyway, so it comes the day of the concert, we get up, we sing, and then we're done. And then one of the tenors disappears. The tenor is just gone. And we find out later that he went directly from the concert to a taxi to the hospital because he'd been having crushing chest pain for 2 days. Like, what? Who does that? But I guess he really wanted to sing in the Lincoln Center. Anyway, he didn't die. He's okay, but he was in the hospital a long time. But his defense was that he had the chest pain and just decided he was not going to interrupt his plans with a heart attack, and he just went to the pharmacy and got a bunch of aspirin, and he didn't die, which is, I think, pretty cool. So ever since then, I've always had aspirin in the house, just in case somebody has a heart attack while they're sitting in my house. All right, there's other platelet inhibitors. There's other all different kinds of blood thinners. I hope we're going to get to a whole lecture just on that. For now, if you can remember aspirin, let's start there. Plavix is another drug you're going to see a lot. It's sometimes used in combination with aspirin, and sometimes it's used for people that are allergic to aspirin, which is kind of cool. But anyway, aspirin, you know about aspirin. Okay, there's another very powerful oral anticoagulant, which is called warfarin. There's some new ones on the market now, like Xarelto. But warfarin is, I know you've seen that a couple times in my videos because, or not my videos, in my handouts, because warfarin is famous for being incredibly having tons of drug interactions, P450 interactions. Also, warfarin has all sorts of dietary restrictions because it works sort of in a way that has to do with vitamin K. And so people's diets can actually change blood levels of warfarin, which you might say, well, all right, it changes the blood level a little bit. The problem is, say you're on warfarin because you have angina or atrial fibrillation, or you have maybe a fake heart valve or something like that, and your blood level of warfarin goes a little bit too low. So let's think it through, right? So if your blood level of warfarin gets a little bit too low, then it's not gonna work, and then you'll get a blood clot, and then you might die, depending on why you're taking the warfarin, right? So the blood level gets a little too low, you die of your blood clot. If the warfarin level gets a little bit too high, then you bleed to death, which is not good either. So it's one of those drugs that you'll see a lot of patients on, but nobody ever puts a patient on warfarin like just because it's Tuesday. There should always be a good reason, because it's so difficult to manage. The blood levels go up and down. You know, the patients have to put up with, you know, bruising and bleeding and things like that in order to, you know, treat whatever the underlying condition is. So that's a big thing. And actually, my exterminator told me, I asked him about strychnine, because if you'll remember in the CNS handout, we talked about strychnine being the antagonist to glycine. And in the Middle Ages, they used strychnine as rat poison. That was sort of the classic rat poison drug. But now nowadays, my exterminator tells me that they use sort of a form of warfarin. And so the little rodents eat the little cheese. It's all full of this warfarin stuff. And then they go back to their little huts, or I guess they don't live in huts. Mice live in like burrows or something, right? And then they scratch their little toes and then they bleed to death. Oh no, it's so sad. But that's the way the cookie crumbles. So blood thinners, again, they're dangerous, but very useful. And warfarin is a nasty one, but you'll see it used all the time because it works really well. And then lastly, I just want to mention heparin, another drug you're going to see a ton of when you work in the hospital, because heparin you can give IV. And it's nice because almost the moment it gets into the bloodstream, it starts working as an anticoagulant. And then if you need to stop the anticoagulant activity of the heparin, you can add this other thing called protamine. You can add to make the heparin stop working, which is really nice to have that kind of control. Now, I should mention that warfarin takes a couple of days to start working. What will happen is, say a patient comes in, they need to have an anticoagulant because, say, they have a big blood clot in their leg. You know, they have a DVT in their leg. And if you have a big clot in your leg, then that would go from your body. It would go to your right heart and then goes to your lungs, and that would give you a pulmonary embolism. So that's why it's not good to have a big clot in your leg. But what you'll see happen with patients is you bring them into the hospital, you put them on the heparin so that the clot doesn't get any bigger, and then you start them on warfarin at the same time. It takes a couple days for warfarin to start working, and once that's working, you can take them off the heparin and go about your business. So blood thinners, that's a whole category unto itself. But just for me, if you can just know aspirin, right? It's the easiest low dose stuff, definitely helps you from having strokes and heart attacks or recurrent strokes or heart attacks. Warfarin is much more difficult to work with, but very effective. And then heparin is something you'll see used in the hospital. You might also see it used subcutaneously as an outpatient for blood thinning for other things. Sometimes people use it just to keep a IV lock, you know, that's in the person's arm, just to keep it from getting a clot in it. You'll see that too. All right, so that's blood thinners. Oh my God. All right, so we're gonna get through just these few pages and then you can escape and go do Halloween stuff. Okay, all right, next, aspirin was exciting. I mean, I get very excited about aspirin, but nitrates are also extremely cool. So nitrates, right, nitroglycerin, which we've talked about before, nitroglycerin is the same stuff they make explosives out of, right? And in fact, when I first learned about that, I always wondered, like, could you take your grandma's nitroglycerin and make something blow up? But evidently you can't. There's something about the way it's made. You can't make explosions. But what's relevant about that is that the nitroglycerin, the reason that there are chemicals that explode is because they're very reactive with whatever they come in contact with. And nitroglycerin is the same way. So if a patient has a bunch of nitroglycerin pills, they can't just keep it like in their plastic pill container because it will just melt the plastic, which is not good. So nitroglycerin has to be kept in little sort of dark glass containers, and it has to be kept in a cool place, not cool like Nidocaine. I mean, like, I'm so old. Like a cool, you know, a temperature wise, it's a cool place. If you have to give nitrates IV, you have to use special tubing, which is kind of like, you know, a pain. But you just have to be aware that it like physically reacts with its environment. So that's important. Now, nitrates work through nitric acid. I think I have that on the handout here. Nitric oxide. It's just, you know, N, can I do this upside backwards? Triple bond O. That's the chemical formula. And nitric oxide also is very interesting in terms of the genetics of it and how it differs between races and things like that. It's really kind of an interesting physiological thing. But the only problem with drugs that work through nitric oxide is that the body becomes very tolerant to it very quickly. So quickly, in fact, that you have to give the patients a break from their nitrates once a day or the nitrate will stop working, which is not what you want. All right. So because of that, you have to tell the patients to not use their nitrates at some point during the day. Now, if they're just taking pills, hopefully they're only taking the nitroglycerin pills when they're having chest pain, which hopefully is not constantly and only once a day or something like that. But if they're using a patch or a paste, then they have to remove that patch. Usually you tell the patients to remove it at night because hopefully at that point they're laying flat and they're asleep, so their heart isn't having to work very hard anyway. In terms of the paste, now that's something you'll probably be doing in the hospital. The orders for nitroglycerin paste are actually just 1.5 inches, you know, on the left arm or something like that. And so all you do is you take this stuff, it's like in a toothpaste tube, and you just go, you know, onto their skin. There's a little measuring thing you can use, like 1.5 inches of goo. I wonder if they use millimeters nowadays instead of inches. Somebody will have to tell me, I don't know. And then you just take an occlusive dressing like Tegaderm. It's like a Band-Aid, and you just, you know, rub it in and squash it on there, and that holds it in place. It's sort of a do-it-yourself dosing of a patch, which is kind of nice. So if they have to have it removed at night, you just pull that off, and then you sort of scrape off the paste that's sitting there. Nitroglycerin also comes as a nasal spray, and it also comes, I think, as a spray you can spray into your mouth. So lots of different ways to do it. Now, I mentioned nitroglycerin the very first day of lecture because I was talking about first-pass metabolism. So remember, in the movies, the guy has chest pain, and then he takes the pill out of the little bottle, and he puts it in his mouth. So he doesn't just put it in his mouth and swallow it. He puts it under his tongue because if he swallows it, it won't work because it will, the first pass metabolism is just too high. That's my cat meowing, I apologize. There are some oral nitrates that you can give, and I think one's listed on the handout. But the thing about that is that the dose has to be much higher, right? Now here's a question I asked, I think, the Thursday class. I was trying to trick them. I won't try to trick you on test, but I just wanna, so think about this one. So is the dose of a nitroglycerin paste gonna be higher or lower than the, let's make sure I ask this correctly, than the dose of the pill you put under your tongue, like from theoretical point of view, assuming that you absorb them both the same amount? I should have some Jeopardy music or something. So the thing there is that the dose, theoretically, if you get as much absorption under your tongue as you do through your skin, then the dose theoretically would be the same. Right? You only have a difference in dose if the patient swallows it. So the dose, if you give it IV, if you're doing it as a patch, assuming 100% absorption, which isn't going to work. Still down in inches. Thank you. Thank you. It's all still down in inches. That's good. Okay. All right. So for first pass metabolism, if you're worried about like, what's the dose of this versus the dose of this, you know, you're going to learn those doses, but you know that the dose oral, anything where it goes through the intestines or the stomach, that's always going to be a much larger dose than any other route, because if your liver is deactivating at all, that's going to be a problem. Okay, let me look at my handout actually here for a second, just make sure I'm not missing anything. All right, we seem to be going along pretty well. We're getting there. Getting there. Okay. In terms of side effects, all right, let me tell you first of all how to administer the nitroglycerin pills, okay? So I am told that this is still the way it's done. Okay, so a patient says to you, chest pain, because I guess that's how your patients talk. And you say, oh, I'll get you your nitroglycerin pills, sir or ma'am. And you give them one, put it under their tongue, and you wait. And usually the chest pain should go away within a minute or two. Because if you think about it, you know, if you get that nice absorption in the mouth, then that goes right, you know, goes to your heart, your liver, your heart. I mean, it's like right, it's there, it's quick, it's fast absorption. Right. So it should get better within 5 minutes. If it doesn't get better within 5 minutes, you give them another one. And then you wait 5 minutes, right? Now 10 minutes have passed. Still have chest pain. Ugh. So now you give them one more. If it still doesn't help the chest pain, then you have to sound the alarm. All right, so you have to say, okay, now this is either becoming unstable angina or this is a heart attack. Patient's gonna need the EKG. We need to like get the cardiac team on the job, right? So generally speaking, it's you give one pill three times, 5 minutes apart. So that's a total of 10 minutes of giving pills. And usually you'll start to sort of have a sense of if things are not going to improve, but that's a good thing too. Thank you. Okay. All right. So that's how to do that. So when you give the patient their nitrate, say you have a patient who's come in, they were worked up for chest pain in the ER. They decided it was angina. I don't know. They bring them into the hospital. And so they're having their sort of first, you know, experience with, nitroglycerin. The first thing that happens is they get a headache. Now, the reason they get a headache and the reason that nitrates help angina, I guess that's an important thing to know, is that they dilate coronary arteries. So nitrates dilate your coronary arteries. Now, nitrates also dilate all your other blood vessels too. So your nitrates dilate your coronary vessels, which is what you want, but they also dilate your all your other coronary vessels, all your other body vessels. And when all your blood vessels dilate, your blood pressure drops, of course your heart rate goes up, right? And so if a patient takes nitrate for the first time and they get that sudden drop of blood pressure, which happens, and then they stand up, then all the blood goes down to their feet and they pass out and fall over. Now you will tell patients, and this is true, pretty much any drug that can lower blood pressure can cause this thing called orthostatic hypotension, which means that your blood pressure drops when you sit up or stand up. And you will tell your patients, you will say, I'm giving you this drug. It might make you dizzy. Do not get out of bed without calling me. Don't get out of bed. Under no circumstances, get out of bed. And then somebody always gets out of bed and falls down, hits their head or breaks their hip. And then you have to write it up and it's a big event and everyone's all upset because patients, there's always patients who don't believe you that it's a worrisome thing. So if that happens to you, I mean, every nurse I know has told me that at some point some patient stood up who she specifically told not to stand up. And it's just human nature and you just have to forgive people for being humans. What are you gonna do? But the point is that because nitroglycerin can dilate all the blood vessels of your body, including the coronary vessels, you have to be careful of this orthostatic hypotension. Now, when you have orthostatic hypotension, the blood pressure drops. And whenever your blood pressure drops, what happens? I can't hear anybody. I feel like I'm Mr. Rogers or something talking to the camera. No one to speak to me. So when the blood pressure drops, you get what's called reflex tachycardia because the baroreceptors in your body detect a drop in blood pressure. That sends a signal to your brain saying, blood pressure is too low. And that increases sympathetic nervous system output, which then causes the norepinephrine to be released on your heart, bind beta-1 receptors, and then make your heart beat faster. Right? Okay. So that's reflex tachycardia mediated by the sympathetic nervous system. And you have to be careful of that because we just said that in angina, you don't want the heart rate to get too high because then it uses up more oxygen and then you're out of luck. So that's something you just have to keep an eye on. Fortunately, a lot of patients who have angina are on another drug to keep that reflex tachycardia from being a problem, but you have to be aware of it. Now, that same problem, the orthostatic hypotension and the reflex tachycardia, are the reason why drugs like Viagra and Cialis, and there's another one that's used all the time, for some reason I can never remember the name of it. They all end with dafil. It says on the video, on the, see how it says afil and afil here? I quite like tadalafil because it's like, ta-da, you have an erection, so, which is nice, I guess. But the problem with mixing these drugs with nitrates is that the effect of those drugs and the nitrates, they synergize. The reason that those drugs work for erectile dysfunction is they cause a dilation of the corpus cavernosum in the penis, which then allows the penis to fill with blood and then become erect. I don't know what that was supposed to be, but you know what I mean. And so because these drugs cause dilation of blood vessels and nitrates cause dilation of blood vessels, you get this massive drop in blood pressure, which can kill you one of two ways, especially if you have angina. The first way it can kill you is by causing a massive drop in blood pressure. If the blood pressure, if your blood pressure gets too low and your brain doesn't have any oxygen, I mean, it doesn't take long and then you die. So you're, low blood pressure, super low blood pressure, that's shock. So that's, you don't want to be in shock. That's not good. The other way it can kill you if you're having, say you're taking nitrates for angina, is that you get this massive drop in blood pressure and you get this massive reflex tachycardia. So your heart just starts pounding away at like 300 beats a minute or whatever. And then you croak because you've had a myocardial infarction. So the sad thing about the drugs, it's not sad about Viagra and Cialis, but what's sad is these supplements that are sold as natural supplements to people with the idea that these are all natural herbs, so they won't interact with your nitrates and they're perfectly safe to take. And those are those supplements. I think I've told you about them. My favorite one is named Sexy Monkey. That's my favorite name of a supplement. It's actually just chock full of Viagra. It's not full of unicorn horn and daffodils like it says it is. It's actually just Viagra, which is very sad. Anyway, so that's not good. Isosorbide dinitrate is basically an oral version of nitroglycerin, and that's, again, a much higher dose because of first-pass metabolism. All right, now beta blockers. We're going to talk briefly about beta blockers. How are we doing on time? We're going to be done earlier than we would be at school because I'm not going to take a break, and the cat has left the room, so we should be okay. Now, beta blockers, you already know about beta blockers, I hope, right? Specifically beta-1 blockers. And the idea here is just that you make it so the heart can't beat too fast, and if the heart can't beat too fast, then your oxygen demand won't outstrip your oxygen supply, and you'll be okay. My son, who is now 20, but he used to come with me when I gave these lectures when he was about, I don't know, maybe 12 or something. And he'd sit in the back of the room while I gave a lecture. And one time we were driving home and he said, "Mom, you're not telling it right with the beta blockers. There's a much better way to describe this." And he is right. This is the way to talk about beta blockers and angina. So if you're driving, say you're driving a car, all right, and it's a fancy car, and you want to drive it 300 miles an hour. If you put a brick underneath the accelerator, right, so that the accelerator pedal can't go down all the way to the floor of the car. It only can go down a little bit. If you put a brick there, then no matter how hard you push on the accelerator, the car can't go any faster. Right. So now imagine you have an old beat up car, like the one I gave my son to use, which is my old crappy Toyota, which is barely running now. Now that car, you can imagine that, if you push it to its limit, it just dies, right? So one way to keep the car going, just so that it can get you from point A to point B, is to not push the accelerator down all the way. That's probably the president or Hollywood, so we'll just ignore that. Hold on. I'll let the thing get it. Nobody ever calls me. No, I won't have the Nobel Prize. Sorry. All right. So anyway, so if you keep the car from going too fast, the car won't break, right? So that's the idea with angina. by giving a patient a beta blocker, no matter how hard they exert themselves or how much you scare them or how much cocaine they take or whatever it is people do in their own time, their heart rate cannot get past a certain limit. So at some point they can't, their heart just can't beat any faster. And you might say, well, that seems kind of dangerous, right? I mean, it does seem kind of dangerous. So the example I like to the mental image I like is that you have some old lady with a lot of cats, right? So you have some tiny little old lady who lives by herself in her apartment with her 27 cats or whatever. And so this involves a lot of vacuuming. So if you're going to have to vacuum up all the cat hair, and even with a Roomba, you're going to need to vacuum, right? So she's off. She's got a little stable angina. She starts vacuuming, and then she gets chest pain and she gets scared. So she turns off the vacuum and goes and sits down. She's like, okay, the chest pain went away. Okay, I'm okay. I'm not going to vacuum anymore. Right. So a couple weeks go by, the cat hair builds up, and then she says, well, I better sweep up because it's getting gross. So she gets out the broom, she starts sweeping up, and then she gets chest pain. And she's like, oh, I better not do that. I better sit down and rest. Right. So now she's not moving at all. So she gets a Roomba or a maid or something. Right. And now she's really not getting up very much at all because she notices that even when she gets up to answer the door, when the Peapod guy comes to deliver her crates of cat food, that she starts having chest pain. So she tells her children and they put her in sort of assisted care. And then pretty soon she's in a wheelchair. And you see this happen with patients. If a patient gets into a wheelchair, it's extremely difficult to get them out because you get deconditioned very quickly, right? So it only takes a week or two. Any of you that work out regularly, you know that if you take a couple weeks break, it's hard when you start up again. And the same thing happens with these patients. And the more they are afraid to move, the poorer condition their cardiovascular system gets in. So the idea with a beta blocker is you have our little old lady with the vacuum cleaner, she's vacuuming, and her heart just won't go any faster. And you know, even when you're young and healthy, if you reach your limit of exercise, I mean, you don't fall over with a heart attack. You just, okay, I'm just gonna take a break. That happens to everybody. The better shape you're in, the more you can do before you get to that point. And so with the little old lady with the vacuum cleaner, she'll just vacuum until her heart rate maxes out, but it's not too high. It's just to that upper limit of the beta blocker. And then she can sit down and rest, and then she can get up and vacuum a little bit more. So that's the idea here, is that you're increasing the exercise tolerance of these old patients with bad hearts. That's the idea. And if you can increase their exercise tolerance, their tolerance for exercise, you will keep them healthy longer. You will keep their body able to function longer. Because, I mean, there's a lot of things you can do to prolong a person's life, but you don't want their life to be miserable. You would like them to be as active as possible. So that's the idea. So there's a beta 1 blocker we've already talked about. There's tons of them. Remember, they all end with all-lol, right? All the beta 1 blockers end with all-lol, like atenolol. That's one you already sort of norm. No, I'm just looking at the name Tenorman. So it's supposed to be like your normal Tenorman is the idea. And you use it for angina. You can also use it for high blood pressure. Lots of things you can use it for. Now I'm mentioning also propranolol, which you'll recall is that non-specific beta 1 and beta 2 blocker. And every time we look at propranolol, it's more... there's more stuff to learn about it. So this time what we'll learn about it, last time we learned that you shouldn't give it to patients with lung trouble because it has beta two blocking activity. This time what you're going to learn is the black box warning for propranolol, which is here, which is that if you have a patient, say they've had a heart attack, and a lot of patients who've had a myocardial infarction get put on propranolol because as the heart heals from the MI, sometimes they can get arrhythmias that propranolol can fix. But also you might be on propranolol for some reason, you're on that because of angina. But if you have a bad heart and you're on propranolol for, you know, a couple of months or something, and then you suddenly stop taking the drug, the patient who was vacuuming happily won't realize that now they don't have that protection, they don't have that brick under the accelerator anymore. And so they can overexert themselves and have, you know, a myocardial infarction or something really bad. So there's many drugs where you don't want the patient to stop it suddenly. Propranolol is one of them. There's another one we'll talk about later called clonidine. And what you have to do, there's patient education that you have to do, because you have to tell the patient, look, do not run out of your prescription and then like wait 3 days to call it in and, you know, have somebody pick it up at the pharmacy. You always have to have some pills at home. Don't run out and then get your refills. And that's just, you just have to like look them in the eye and make sure that they hear you when you say that, because patients do it all the time. All right. Lastly, I still would, please text me if you have any questions. I hope that I'm still online. I mean, I have no way, I don't really know how I would even know if I'm still online. That's how sad this situation is. Is there a way to figure out if I'm still online? Oh, there it is. All right, it says I'm still online. Okay, I'm just gonna finish up then. All right, lastly, the last class of drugs we're gonna talk about is calcium channel blockers. All right, now, nitrates, as I mentioned, they dilate coronary vessels and they dilate all your vessels. So they dilate coronary vessels and they do that reducing preload and afterload thing, which helps too. That's also helpful. Calcium channel blockers are the same way. They will dilate coronary vessels and they'll also dilate other vessels in your whole body. So they help angina not only by dilating the coronary vessels, but also by making the heart work easier, making the heart's exertion easier. Now, before I go into calcium channel blockers, let me just sort of backtrack and just say one thing, which is, remember we talked about norepinephrine and epinephrine and alpha-1 receptors causing vasoconstriction through the non-essential parts of your body. So are the coronary vessels essential or non-essential? I would argue that coronary vessels are extremely essential, especially if you're running from a bear, right? You don't want your heart to not be able to beat if you're running from a bear. That would not be good. So things like alpha-1 blockers won't help coronary vessels dilate, right? Because there shouldn't be much in the way of alpha-1 receptors on your coronary vessels. Your body has specifically isolated beta-1 receptors in terms of blood pressure stuff, right? Because you have beta-1 receptors on your SA node, which increase heart rate and increase heart contractility. So that's a heart thing. Then there's beta-1 receptors on your kidneys, and that increases renin, which activates angiotensin. And angiotensin causes vasoconstriction, right? So that's another way that blood pressure goes up. And then angiotensin also leads to other things like aldosterone, which increases blood pressure by increasing blood volume, right? So beta-1 is all, it's all, beta-1 is blood pressure. And that'd be a good way to remember it too. They both start with B, I guess. Beta-1 is blood pressure stuff, right? So alpha-1, the point is alpha-1 is not going to cause vasoconstriction of coronary vessels because that would be counterproductive, right? So just keep that in mind because there's definitely going to be questions on the test where I say, here's a drug. Will it kill the angina patient? Will it kill the heart failure patient? If it does, or the atrial fibrillation patient? And if it does, how are you going to prevent that from happening? So make sure when you're thinking about coronary vessels, you don't get that mixed up with the alpha-1 stuff. Okay, so calcium channel blockers and nitrates are really the only big drug classes that specifically will help dilate coronary vessels as well. Calcium channel blockers, basically they work by making, it all has to do with calcium movement in and out of cells, which has to do with electrical communication in the heart, and it also has to do with strength of contraction in muscles. So hopefully you remember that when you had to study skeletal muscles and they had that business with the, you know, they have the actin and then in the inside they had the myosin, and the myosin had like the little, I have to like back up for my interpretive dance of myosin and actin, but you know, they had the little troponin heads that would like stick onto the actin and move it along. Kind of cool. Anyway, you'll recall that there was troponin, and remember, and then there was calcium, and calcium was in the sarcoplasmic reticulum, and it would come out, and that would help with the contraction of the muscle. So it turns out that if you have increased calcium inside of a cell, the contraction of actin and myosin in skeletal muscle and smooth muscle and cardiac muscle is going to be stronger. It's going to be a stronger thing, all right? So let's think about coronary blood vessels. So let's, the coronary arteries in particular. Okay, so you have a coronary artery, right? And it has sort of an outside part, it has an inner endothelial lining, and then it has that muscle, right? So if we reduce the amount of calcium inside the smooth muscle of your artery, does the artery constrict, tightly, or does it relax? And the way it works is it relaxes, right? So if you have the coronary artery has calcium in it, then it relaxes. And if it relaxes, it dilates. Remember, a normal coronary vessel can dilate up to 5 times its original diameter, which is kind of cool, right? Right. So the calcium channel blockers, they basically block the movement of calcium. So you get that relaxation of the smooth muscle in the coronary artery, and then you get more blood flow. Fantastic. Now, you also get that same relaxation of artery wall muscle, smooth muscle, in the rest of your body. So calcium channel blockers can also be used to reduce just blood pressure, hypertension, having high blood pressure. So they're good for that too. Now, it turns out that when you have, I'm switching gears now to the heart, and specifically the right atrium, where you have that SA node. And so when the SA node, that pacemaker cells fire, and you get that spreading of electrical activity that causes then the atrium to contract, that cardiac action potential, which is not exactly the same as a regular nerve action potential. And the reason it's not exactly the same as a nerve action potential is because not only are there sodium and potassium channels, but there's also calcium channels. So because calcium is involved with the propagation of the current through the atrium, you can use calcium channel blockers to help treat some types of arrhythmias, including atrial fibrillation is one of those. Right? So that's another thing you can use. Basically, what it does is it just slows down the propagation of that electrical signal, and it particularly slows down the AV node. Remember, there's the SA node, and then there's the AV node between the atria and the ventricles, and then the AV node, it goes from there through the bundle of His and the Purkinje fibers and all that stuff. So so it works for that too. Now, lastly, the calcium, amount of calcium in your smooth muscle in your intestines, if that's too low, then your intestines relax, right? And if your intestines relax, then you're constipated, right? Because, I mean, I think of it like, I imagine you having your intestines sort of like spread out like this. Let's see if I can get myself on the picture here. All right, so if your intestines are like a big, like you have a, like a big tube sock full of, whatever you like. If you squeeze that tube sock with peristalsis, right, really strong, it squirts all the stuff out the bottom. That's diarrhea, right? So if the tube sock just is relaxed, then nothing's going to move. And if your large intestine isn't moving, the poop just gets drier and harder and more difficult to pass. So the constipation from calcium channel blockers is thought to be epic, and you need to warn your patients about it by, you know, saying, it might make you constipated, increase your fluids. You know, you might have to give them a stool softener. We'll talk about that stuff when we do the GI lecture. But just be aware of that. Now, my personal mnemonic is really disgusting, so you might have to like cover your ears and hum for a second if you don't want to hear something gross. But the way I remember the calcium channel blockers and aluminum antacids cause constipation is I just imagine a rectum that's filled with like a big ball of chalk, you know, like calcium carbonate, like chalk, right? Okay, it, for some reason that mental image, it never goes away. And so I always remember calcium channel blockers cause constipation. Similarly for aluminum antacids, which will be in the next section, not this test. I just imagine a big ball of aluminum foil sort of shoved into someone's rectum. It's gross, but I never forget. So that's good. Some students have told me a little bit less disgusting way of remembering is that calcium channel blockers start with C and they're blockers, so they block you up and they make you constipated. That's okay too, but there's a lot of things called blockers, like beta blockers. I think that's not as useful as a disgusting visual. All right, now we're gonna talk about calcium, we're gonna finish talking about heart failure probably in class next week. You should know that calcium channel blockers are generally contraindicated in heart failure, especially when we talk about left ventricular heart failure with reduced ejection fraction. And that's because with heart failure, the problem is that the heart is already too weak, right? So you don't want the muscle of the heart getting relaxed because it's already so weak. If you make it more weak, then it's just going to make the heart failure worse and the backup of fluid into your lungs and all that stuff, that's worse. So in a person who has isolated left ventricular heart failure, you wouldn't want to give calcium channel blockers, generally speaking. All right, so that would be a contraindication. I'll just let you know right now, because you can write it as a little list, of a few drugs that we're going to talk about that you should not use in left ventricular heart failure with reduced ejection fraction, which is the only heart failure we're going to talk about, but I just have to be specific, is you don't want to use calcium channel blockers. You don't want to use propranolol, because you get that beta-1 blocker action, which reduces heart rate, sure, but it also reduces contractility, so that's not going to work so well. So propranolol in particular. There are some beta blockers you use, but not propranolol. And then the other one that's generally contraindicated is mannitol, which is an osmotic diuretic, and you would not want to use that if somebody's in acute pulmonary edema, like their heart failure suddenly got worse, and they have horrible pulmonary edema. I hate to sort of have a little side there about heart failure, but I'm just write that on the side. Just like drugs not to use in heart failure, propranolol, calcium channel blockers, and mannitol. And then just put a little box and an arrow or something. All right. Then we're going to go back. All right, so let's finish up with this. Now, we're still talking about angina, right? All right, so angina, you're getting the effect, the angina, the reason it's good for angina is because it dilates coronary vessels, it reduces preload and afterload, so it's helping reduce the work of the heart. There's sort of two main types of calcium channel blockers. Some of them are named in a way that helps you remember them because they all end with dopine. Right? And then there's verapamil and diltiazem, which are sort of their own thing. They're thought to bind slightly different kinds of receptors. It's the thing I think probably clinically to know about it is that these two don't end with dopine, so it's harder to remember them. So whatever. Verapamil I actually mentioned on the first day because that's one of those, it's a drug that has very high first pass metabolism. And so the IV dose, which is like 5 milligrams, is much lower than the oral dose, which might be 125 milligrams starting dose. So I think that's the context in which I mentioned it the first day of class because of this high first pass metabolism. Verapamil tends to be used a lot for things like atrial fibrillation. Diltiazem is used a lot for blood pressure. Notice that Calan, which is one of the trade names for verapamil, C-A-L-A-N, C-A like calcium, see how it helps you remember the drug. All right, now the nifedipine is a drug that's a terrific drug. It helps bring down blood pressure pretty quickly. And the people who made the drug thought, well, let's make a drug that brings down your blood pressure even more quickly. Because, you know, sometimes you're in the emergency room and a patient comes in and their blood pressure is 300 over something. You're like, I got to get the blood pressure down. So you want something that works fast. So they came out with a form of nifedipine, which is this fast-acting form, right? Which does help bring blood pressure down quickly. The problem is that if you have angina, right, and you bring down their blood pressure really fast, then they get reflex tachycardia, and then they get a heart attack, right? So that's, you want to be careful about that, right? So how would you prevent, an angina patient from having reflex tachycardia when you give them their calcium channel blocker or their nitrate? So the reflex tachycardia is mediated after a perceived drop in blood pressure, is mediated by the sympathetic nervous system, stimulating, releasing norepinephrine at the SA node, stimulating the beta-1 receptors to cause the heart rate to go faster, right? So the way to prevent reflex tachycardia is to give a beta blocker. So if you give beta blockers to a patient, and then you give them something that would normally cause reflex tachycardia, you won't get it because the heart will have no way to get any faster because it only can get faster with the beta ones on the sympathetic side, and it only can get slower with the muscarinic receptors from the vagus nerve and acetylcholine on the parasympathetic side. So that's the way you do it. Now, that being said, if you give your patient, let's give them some beta blocker and some nitrate and some calcium channel blocker, it's their first day in the hospital, when they stand up, they are definitely going to pass out because now you've made it so that their body can't compensate for a sudden drop in blood pressure. So, you know, every drug has a side effect. What are you going to do? Now, a couple other quick drugs for angina, nice ones. Morphine is very nice because morphine, not only is it a good drug for pain, not only, and it makes you constipated and people get a little bit euphoric from it, but it also dilates veins, which is very nice because it reduces preload, which helps angina and then definitely helps heart failure, pulmonary edema, caused by heart failure. And also patients who are in the throes of having a heart attack or pulmonary edema are very frightened. So the morphine helps a little bit with that terror, just sort of on its own. And then oxygen, because oxygen is good. So, you know, you have a patient with a heart problem, you know, there's that thing sticking out of the wall that will blow oxygen. So you might as well stick a tube in there and, you know, put it in the patient's nose and nasal cannula so that it can breathe oxygen. All right, now, so that's the end of that stuff, right? I'm going to let you go. Let me just tell you about what's going on for next week. And then I'll wait around to see if you guys text me or whatever. For next week, hopefully you got the homework assignment I emailed you, which was about heart failure and about those crash course videos, right? For next week, what I would like you to do, or I'm worried that I'm going to make it's happened again. Oh God. All right, here we go. All right, so it's on D2L. It's also on this, on my regular boyev.com. If you look at, here it is, heart failure angina, critical thinking, CSI displays. I know it's silly, but all right. What I did Thursday and what I'm probably going to offer for Tuesday too, is that instead of giving them the quiz, I gave them the homework assignment I gave you because I didn't want to lose time lecturing. And so everyone in the Thursday class swore to me, like scout's honor, that if I didn't give a quiz next week, they would all study anyway, right? And since I didn't believe them, I decided to have them do yet another homework assignment. So the Friday people, you get stuck doing two homework assignments, but you don't have to have two quizzes. So, and you're welcome to work on this with other students. I would just ask that you not just copy off of another student because it looks gross if you do that. And also you aren't going to learn anything if you don't like try to work it out yourself. So these are going to be questions that are a little bit similar to the ones on the test, which is I give you a patient with heart failure or I give you a patient with angina and then I give them some other disease other drug. And then you have to tell me what happens. So in this one with congestive heart failure, I give an aldosterone agonist. I could give you an aldosterone antagonist, an ACE inhibitor or a ARB. I could give you an angiotensin agonist or antagonist. Aldosterone agonist or antagonist would be something like florinef is an agonist, an antagonist would be spironolactone. I misspoke. I apologize. I could give you an angiotensin antagonist like an ACE inhibitor or an ARB. I could give you epinephrine or amphetamines, right? That stimulates alpha 1, beta 1, beta 2. I could give you those things in combination with atropine or with a beta block or something like that. So make sure you have that whole sequence down as to all the things that are affecting blood pressure, which are going to be heart rate, vasoconstriction, and blood volume, right? So those things. So if you'll work through those, this little sign is 2 pages, right? That's going to help prepare you for the test. And it's also going to help, and then that'll be something that I can grade and give you points for. So hopefully that'll be an easy way to get some points. The other thing to mention, let me not forget, I also have some clinical cases. Again, I'm not giving you a quiz, but I still want you to study because I don't want the night before the test you'd be all like freaking out and having to take Valium. I don't want that to happen. So here's some clinical cases that I've written for you. And again, this is to help prepare you for the exam. If you can answer these questions, hopefully that'll help you a lot, especially on the sort of, here's patients, what do you want to do with it? You know, what drug is indicated or something like that. All right, so that'll help you. Now, is there anything else I need to tell you? Oh, and then the last thing is this, again, atrial fibrillation's guideline worksheet. So if you look at this, let's look at this together, all right? What I've done is I basically start you off and just tell you what to read and how to interpret it, okay? So you only print out the first 20 pages, and then I even tell you what page to look at, what table to look at, and fill in the blank. And the idea is that you'll do this assignment. I'm gonna go down to the bottom of it. And at the bottom of it, I give you a practice case study. This is from last semester. The student said, could you please give us a practice case study? Because I just gave them one on the test and they were like all scared and worried. So here's a practice one. And then what we'll do the day of the test in 2 weeks is you'll take the test and that'll be on heart failure, angina, hypertension, and diuretics, and maybe a little bit just about atrial fibrillation, like sort of main goals of therapy. And then after you hand in the test, you're going to take out your notes of this worksheet that I gave you, and you can write whatever you want on that, as well as your copy of the article, which looks like this. Okay, here it comes. Your copy of the article, and then you'll have, it'll be open book. This, after the test, you'll have an open book thing, and I'll give you a new case study, and all you have to do is use this article to tell me how you're going to treat the patient, right? So, and then when you're done with that, you'll hand everything in. You'll hand in your the worksheet, you'll hand in the case study, you'll hand in the practice case study, you'll have everything in at the end, and then you'll be free to go home, and probably I'll have you watch a video about pooping or something. So that'll be so fun. All right, so let me turn off this horrible gateway to another dimension. There it is. All right, I'm gonna just stay online for a few more minutes, and if you guys have any questions, if you're still there even, let me know. I don't know why comments were turned off there. I will try to, if this ever comes up again, I'll try to figure out that, not how that to work, to fix it so you can, it'll work. Okay. All right. I'm going to leave this on for a few minutes, and, but that'll be it. And now you're free and you can go, I don't know, dress up like a witch or something. All right. If we're gonna have to sit online, we might as well have cats. So here's my cat. Look at how cute this is. This is Kishi. I don't think I'll have many videos where a cat is featured, but there you have. She was sleeping, so she's mad. Nothing. Ugh, I would give you guys my text number, but it's not clear to me that this is public or private, so I'm like worried about giving out my cell phone number to the internet. There was actually one guy who, there were a couple of guys who after I did the vomiting, or no, the pooping video, just, they started sending me lots of very strange emails, so I prefer not to give out my number. I'll give you guys another minute to think of a question. Otherwise, you can text me or email me in the usual way. Oh, hey. She was sleeping. She's tired. We're being professional. All right, you guys. I will see you next week. Please call me or text me or email me if you need help in the usual way. Ew! All right, bye. I hope.